we had duplicate controls. There was a center box out here in between the two pilots that was where you actuated the landing gear, flaps, and RPM. A flight engineer had a very important part of a... He also did the cruise control, and it was when you're flying a 3,000-mile mission with no place to sit down. Why, you got to have good cruise control. It seemed like most of the time there at McCook that they finally got enough 29s in there, you know, but they were immediately shipping them overseas, as well as the China Burma group went over, I think, to India in I want to say June or July of 44, and the 73rd Bomb Wing that went to Saipan, they were over there in October of 44. Our 313th Wing got there in January of 45. Then I think the 314th and 315th out of Guam, I think they got there in 45. And of course, Tinian had the biggest bomber base in the world at that time. Had 4,500-foot blacktop runways and could accommodate over 250 B-29s. We picked our aircraft up at Harrington, Kansas, which was a modification base, and that was probably the, I want to say, the first week after the end of 45. And then we flew it to Albuquerque and then on out to Mather Field in California, which is just outside of San Francisco. And there was a lot of B-25s, other aircraft waiting for proper winds so they'd be able to fly all the way to Hawaii. We had a problem. We lost an engine after we were a little more than halfway over there, and had to feather it. And so when we landed there, and I think it was Hickam Field that we landed at. I can't remember for sure. Anyhow, they didn't have anyone to work on it. So all the B-29s that flew over had a spare engine in the front to build up the inventory overseas. So they took ours out of Bombay and switched them. And that's how we got on the Tinian. Generally speaking, they would tell you when the oil pressure was going down and they were going to pressure, do the props and feather the props. And of course, you never argued at that point. I mean, they just let you know that you only got three engines in place of four. I'm not sure, but I think Tinian on the last three or four days, I think. Right. And that was the first time that landing craft went from island to island. They left all out of Saipan, and it was only about 3 miles over there. And And then they landed on Tinian, and I think they put, I heard they put 17,000 people through that landing area that night. And the battleships, they were all up towards the other end of the island, up there where the port was, because that's where the Japanese figured that they were going to come in. And so they were bomb blasting that to make them think that we were getting ready to land up there. And they snuck in on the down at the north end of the island there, actually not too far from where our runways were. How would you feel if, when you got there, Tokyo Rose was welcoming you in, calling you by name, called airplane commanders by name, and I presume that she was somehow was getting her information out of Hawaii, because there were all Japanese there, but she would. You need to turn around and go back, boys. You're going to die over here. And she put some of that beautiful big band music, you know, try to make you homesick, you know, and it didn't work. But we did like to listen to her program. I think we were all committed at that time, really. Because we are already flown over a batch of water, you know what I mean. And with a good navigator and a good flight engineer, you build up confidence in your crew. Yeah, we had 2 or 3 weeks before we had our first mission, and it was a shakedown mission to Truk Island, which was one of the islands that they bypassed when they were jumping islands. You know, they weren't taking them every one as they came. They were jumping and isolate those islands and trying to get where they get us bases to hit Japan. And so it was a submarine base also. We actually bombed it, but it was kind of get your war nerves off, you know. And we had a little anti-aircraft fire, not much. And I think the lead bombardier, I think we were flying formation, and lead bombardier, he dropped him in the bay there instead of up on the land. So I don't think we did any good there. And then I think it was the 18th of February, we had another shakedown mission, and that was to Iwo Jima and to the hot rock up there. And you can see invasion boats, you know, circle around out there. And of course we bombed the airfield there, and outside that, I don't think we did anything. I think that's when the main invasion started, was the 18th. And they thought it was going to be a 5-day affair, and that they finally got it secured, I think, on the 9th or 10th of April. Generally speaking, 9 aircraft, you could have 11 or 12, but that's when they say fell on the diamond, and you got 3 aircraft this way, and filling the diamond is this way, and you can get in the prop wash and work your funny off. Generally speaking, we flew with 3 in the lead, then 3 in the higher with the sub lead, because he was one that keep you so close, and then in the lower. So we flew stacked to the left. Our next mission, there was 4 from our Ninth Bomb Group that got put with one of the, I think the sixth bomb group lacked four planes. And so they put us with them on a high altitude mission to Tokyo. And we went around the target three times. And the second time that we went around, guys began breaking radio silence, you know, what's going on? What's going on? And the old general come on, he says, do you want to go 60 mile an hour or 600 mile an hour? This was the jet stream that your weatherman talks about every night. And that jet stream destroys the bomb pattern. You're lucky to get 25 or 30% into a target area. And you can imagine how mad Washington was with this being the biggest gamble that they took, and we couldn't hit the broadside of the barn over there. And so this was when they dropped, I think there was one more high altitude mission the fore part of April, which we didn't do. And then they dropped us down from 30,000 feet down to 5 to 10,000 feet into a night mission. Well, we couldn't fly formation because we didn't have night flying goggles. So these were all individual aircraft, and the bomber stream lots of times is up over 300 or 400 miles long, from the bombers taking off on three different islands. Well, you took off about every 60 seconds, but you had 7.5 hour trip up there, so maybe this guy was flying a couple miles an hour faster than, so, you know, there was actually no separation. Being nighttime, you didn't fly with your lights on, you know. You could see the blue flames of the exhaust when you got up close. And but of course, if you were high enough, you might not see them. But I don't know that we had any problems that way. Actually, if a guy had to abort the mission and drop these incendiaries, they burn just as well on top of water as they do on land. And basically napalm. And so you really couldn't tell whether or not someone crashed or boarded the mission. All you know is that you didn't see them going home. Now, you had a radar operator and the navigator had a scope. So when you'd be within 150 to 175 mile away from land, why, you could pick up coastline, that type of thing. And actually, a city on it just looked like a glob, kind of a glob would kind of fit inside of the city boundaries, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. If there was rivers going through, you could see rivers, you could see lakes of very decent size. But so actually, the only type of radar bombing that we ever did was if there was a cloud layer below you, and you couldn't see, and of course you hope your navigator has brought you to where the city was, but our bombardier and radar, the navigator would call off a rate, and the bombardier would add this rate into the bomb site. And so they keep changing that a little bit, you know what I mean, so that as you come to the target, that when the rate got to zero, I dropped your load. And but they worked together. We did 22 night single ship missions, and our wing also was appointed to do a lot of the mining in the bays, harbors, and channels. And of course, subs out on the ends out there, why, we cut their shipping over 85%. One of the most effective blockades that's ever been done on the country. We dropped mines, 1,000, 2,000 pound mines by parachute. And they were magnetic. They had counters on them, and they could pick out a certain range of tonnage. And I think the counters went up to 10. So if your mine was set for the fifth one of that particular tonnage, then it would go off. But it wouldn't, it was selective. The bigger the ship, would be able to carry so much tonnage, this type of thing. And evidently would put out, would attract the magnetic portion of it more than the small ship, you know what I mean? So I think they were, had some way or another that that they were able to kind of calibrate tonnage, ship tonnage, and have several different setups. We did not handle any of that. Now the Navy guys came in and went through the mission with us, and every crew had their own mine run. And so there was, you were on your own all the way up and back, and just like the regular incendiary bombers were all night missions. When they dropped us down from 30,000 feet down into the first Blitz mission, the Blitz was four big cities, Tokyo, Nagoya, Osaka, and Kobe. These were the Blitz, and they were done boom, 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 boom. And I might say that the first mission to Tokyo is considered the deadliest mission of any war to date. We burned 16 square miles of Tokyo. Demographics says that they lost over 230,000 people in that one mission. From there, we went to Nagoya, Osaka, and Kobe, and we burned 32 square miles of those cities. Well, it was on the Kobe mission that when we were on the bomb run, it looked like mountains up ahead of us. And so I called Jack, the navigator, and what's these mountains we're coming to up here? And he said, oh my gosh, there's no mountains within 150, 200 miles of us. So shortly thereafter, we run into smoke. And this was smoke off the target. Very, very acrid smoke. To me, it kind of smelled like a musty attic with chicken feathers in it. And you can guess what chicken feathers is. That's human. And so the farther we penetrated in the smoke, the rougher it got. Jack and I decided we would, John and I decided we would fly on autopilot. So he took the course and I took the altitude. And when we got into the heart of the thing, when you'd hit a updraft, the airspeed would drop down to 160. And then when you passed through that into a downdraft, and it was just like a flick of the finger, that airspeed would jump to 330. And this was going on through each updraft, downdraft, just like a pair of scissors. And of course, you were doing a couple hundred miles an hour, you know what I mean? So it doesn't feel like there was any gap whatsoever in between an updraft and downdraft. And how many there were, I couldn't tell you. But I do know that we went through several. And when we got back home next morning, they told us that we had cracked a wing bolt, and those suckers are up around 2 1/4, 2 3/8 diameter. And there's four that holds the wings on. And they decided that that's what they were losing B-29s at night, not the fighters, but they were actually breaking up in these storm clouds. And we actually had one crew that was blown up to, well, he wasn't, he thought he was blown up, but he was on an updraft, up to 11,000 feet on his back. And my feeling is that he was in an updraft, and then he passed over into a downdraft, but he was splitting the hairs this way. The downdraft actually tipped him over, but they pulled it out of the, and their airspeed got up over 400 miles an hour. When they got back to, they did get it all the way back to 10 in, and the crew got out and they pulled it to the junk pile. I mean, very, very severe. And the stench of the smoke is, we had two gunners that were pitching their guts out from, and I don't know, I'm sure that was part of it, but the other part was updrafts and downdrafts. And the bombardier, he looked around at me at one time and then immediately turned back around and went to work on the bomb site. When we got away from there, he said, "Chauncey," he said, "I've never seen two guys looked like you and John looked like death." And we made her through. And that was probably our toughest mission over Kobe. Now, most countries would have capitulated, losing 32 square miles of their big cities. But Japanese didn't. And so actually, by the war's end, we burned 70 cities over there. And our luckiest mission was Nagoya on that blitz. They didn't have much surface wind, and Nagoya is really cut up with channels, and the fires wouldn't jump. Now, Tokyo that night had around a 27, 28 mile an hour surface wind. And our cities had burned just the same. You know, Wichita here, we have those kind of winds all the time. And so I think it's important to tell people that our cities will burn just the same. You're flying, you're busy. I don't remember having much thoughts about it. You got to do your job. And if you're doing your job, you can't be thinking about, have feelings into it. And firebomb raids, let me put it to you this way. If you've ever read the book, The Rape of Nanking, you can will understand how far people can degrade. And so we had nothing kind towards the Japanese, and they were preparing for the invasion. They were teaching those families how to be mean, you know, fight with sticks and stones. Lucky mission we had was a few nights after Osaka, I mean Kobe, when we went back to Nagoya, we didn't, there was this plant just along the edge of Nagoya that the fires didn't take. And so anyhow, I think it was on that mission that when we took off, we took out the two center lights. There's four at the end of the runway. And we took out the two center lights and just run off in the air, and it grabbed, and we flew out to sea about, I judge 45, 50 mile before we could get our engine temperatures down so that we could make a climb even. John says, let's turn on the landing lights and see how close we are. I said, hell no. If we're going in, I don't want to see it. And I never turned them on. And anyhow, a couple hours away from Tinian, we swallowed a valve. And I happened to be looking at the RPM, and it's just a pip. And we were very, very fortunate. It did not start an oil leak, so there wasn't any fire, and we were able to cut back on the throttles away, and we were still getting some use out of the engine. Well, we got up within an hour of Nagoya, and the flight engineer called us and said, I'm shutting, feathering the prop, oil pressure's dropping. And so then John and here we were within an hour of the target, and you needed to hit the target in order to get credit for the mission. So John and I talked it over, and we both said, well, we go in if the crew wanted to go in. But if one of them didn't want, why, we'd return home. So I pulled the crew, every man, let's go. Now, to me, that's real heroism. And so we went in to Nagoya. We were in searchlights all the way across Nagoya. We had AK-AK. We had handguns that can reach up that far. And the navigator said that he saw hand-fired gun go between the engines and the cells. We never took a hit, to my knowledge, from the AK-AK. We flew all the way across in searchlights. I can tell you, you can read the dang-gone newspaper. It's bright, and you just got to keep your head on the instruments and not let it disturb you. And then we flew home, all the way home on three engines, and glad we didn't lose our second one. That's what we got our distinguished flying cross for, that particular mission. You can do it, but over a long period of time, you're going to slowly lose altitude. You couldn't do it with the bomb load in there. And matter of fact, we dumboed one crew back from Tokyo up there, and he couldn't, had been a high altitude mission, and he couldn't transfer fuel out of his bomb bay tank without filling the bomb bays full of fuel, I mean fumes. And you know, that's a no-no. And so he called us, and that happened to be a daylight raid. And so we said, sure, we'd stay with them to where they, if they had to ditch. And they started throwing the stuff out of that plane. Well, they as I recall, they feathered the two inboard engines and flew on with the outboard engines. And I understand that anything that wasn't connected to the framework, they chopped out with their hatchets and to get as light as they could be. And they got all the way back to Iwo Jima. They lost their third engine on the final approach, and the fourth engine died on the runway. Now that's cutting it close. They landed. You could ditch B-29 in pretty decent water, and it would stay together. If the sea was rough, the tail section would break off right behind the wing, and that put the pilot's compartment down 65 feet. And that's quite a ways to come up with if you're trying to get out of them. The tail broke off, then that let the nose just swing on down, and the rear compartment, of course, those guys could get out real easy, and but it would break off right there where the bulkhead was at the, to the rear bomb bay door, and and they had sent out fighter aircraft and sink a bunch of B-29s that ditched off Iwo Jima, and of course, Iwo Jima was a big communications island, Japs island, and so they didn't want any 29s floating over there. You know, they, I think they were about 125 mile away, something like that. So they'd send out fighters to sink them, and kind of sounds silly, but that's, you know, sometimes a guy gets knocked out, and if one of the other guys isn't checking, say who's there. I've heard of a pilot or the other guy yank him up and get him out of there. And I even heard of one time, and I don't know if it's true or not, that Bombardier tried to get out one of the holes in the and knocked the glass out of the nose. And he had his 45 belt on, and that he broke that belt getting out of that window. Now, I don't, that's a tremendous amount of strength to do it. But I have no idea whether or not that story is true or not. But I do know that the guys that were picked up by subs, they stayed on that sub until it was ready to go back home and drop them off. So they might be out there, you know, a month or two. They bring them back to Saipan or Tinian, and they use PBYs. Station along, you know what I mean? We flew a Dumbo mission. That's what they called it, special aircraft that was designed to carry extra supplies and bigger rubber boats for the guys. And then you would contact the sub, you know, give them the points, and then you leave them. And they actually picked guys up right in the Tokyo Bay, submarines did. So those guys, you know, they're something else. We dropped the 2 million ton of bombs for the Air Corps on Wakayama, Japan, and that was the fore part of July, and which I thought was quite an honor. The Grand Crew Chief received the Legion of Merit after the 50th mission, and which was, that's a real nice honor, and because of 50 missions with no aborts, and then it flew two more missions after that. I think the first million ton was dropped by B-17 over New York area someplace, and then they wanted us to fly the 50th mission on our aircraft when we flew our 35th mission. Going Jesse, by war's end, flew 51 bombing mission and won a prisoner of war drop without aborting any mission, which was a record over there. And so they wanted us to fly Going Jesse home. And I'm sure to go on a bond tour when they came to us, we had 32 missions completed. Well, why should we wait three more missions when we could do three missions and be home? And we flew the 46th mission on Going Jesse when we got our 35 missions. And then a secondary crew took over as lead crew, and they flew up the very, I think they were on the last mission, bombing mission, when it was called. But I consider that quite an honor to be asked to fly 29 home. Now, the atomic bomb aircraft was stationed just across the runway from where we were there on, and their aircraft were different than ours in that they did not have any turrets or blusters on them for weight, for speed, to be able to get away from the bomb blast. They did have a tail gunner, I understand. That remote control turret stayed. They dropped the first one on the 6th and the second one on the 9th of August. And then the war was over on the 15th. But we lucked out because one of their crews was going back to the States empty, and they were flying C-54 transport, and which can be used for cargo or personnel, either one. And we left there the 3rd of August, got home the 4th of August. Actually, when we got to Hawaii, our orders were to stay there for 2 weeks, R&R, rest and relaxation, because we didn't get any in our 35 missions. And but as it turned out, the C-54 had to have a 100-hour inspection that was going to take about 10 hours. So we went up to CO and talked him into cutting her orders on into the States when they got their 100-hour inspection done. And they checked your luggage real close when we landed there. And John had, I think, 4 .45s and 2 first aid kits. And when the line first started, why, we were at the very end. And of course, then what do? They start a new line, you know what I mean? Cut it in half. And that put us right at the first. Well, of course, they just opened up John's luggage, put their hand down, and dumped everything out. Now, I did have some photographs up here on my chest, taped up here, that I don't know, there's one or two of them that were sacred. But I just gave him some film of a box camera, and I got that a few months later, and everything was there. Yeah. But they did check you through all right. No. And of course, the first aid kits had morphine on them, you know, so they were gone too. And we had guys that thought we were going to fly Jesse, going Jesse back home. And we had one guy that said he had a small tub of 16 millimeter gun camera that he was using to take pictures around, you know. He warned us, because everyone figured, you know, that they wouldn't be checking out the aircraft, you know, and so guys had all sorts of stuff they wanted us to bring back. And I heard that they were using B-29 fuselages over in the breakwaters at Guam and in place of rock. And of course, the ones that were, it might have been flown home and chopped up. And I heard too, one of the guys that bid on his bid was paid with the fuel that he sucked out of the planes before they were chopped up. I came back and it's kind of funny. I called Jane and said, "Honey, I'm back in the States." And she didn't say, "Well, great," or "I love you," or anything. She said, "When you want to get married?" And so I had to go into on train on into Kansas City. And She walked me all over that place. I was dead tired, and because I sat on my duffel bag from Denver into Kansas City in between the cars. And matter of fact, when I left San Francisco, we actually had women coming through offering to sleep with you so that they'd have a place to stay. I mean, the trains were so full, you know what I mean, that gals were offering themselves to be able to have a, because if they didn't have a seat, they couldn't go on the train. And no, I was dedicated young man, and glad of it. And so we were married on the 14th of August, and I tell people I started my Third World War there. But it wasn't. She was a wonderful woman. As a matter of fact, we were on our honeymoon when we got to, we went to Lake Tanacoma, and which is Branson now. And so heard all this racket, you know, and went to the door and, "What's going on? The war's over." Boom. We went back out to Santa Ana then for new orders. Well, there was just so much partying going on, and Jane didn't like it, and I didn't care much for it either, and I couldn't see that the Air Corps was going to change any, you know, I mean, that it was going to, there wasn't anything I could see in the future for them to do. So I got out, and I had to sign up into a National Guard. And so I had to fly, I had to go to Coffeyville, Kansas from Chanute. I think once a month, and they had an AT-6 and an AT-11, and I never got checked out in either one of them, but you had to have ground school and do so much there. And so when they started, they closed that field and opened up Fairfax, Kansas City. And then when they started paying them, that's when I literally got out. And that way they didn't have any hooks on me to, of course I didn't know about Corps In coming up, but I would have been right in that if I would have been, you know, I would have got called back. I went to work for my father-in-law then. He, of course, was working shorthanded. And one of the fellows that was working there that was over in Europe, and I got home before he did, and he told me I was doing his position, and he said, "You go ahead and stay with that." And so he wound up going to work for the State Highway Commission. Our war probably came about as close to being won by aircraft than any, and of course a lot of people don't like to give us that much credit either, but we didn't land any troops on there until after the war was over. All this stuff that we have today, so much of it come out of World War II, and you need more brain power today than ever before. You know, they had jets over in the European sector, and we had the first remote control our computerized gun sights. So a lot of it started in World War II.